Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.
Good evening, and welcome to Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks County. I'm your host, Amanda Matchick, and tonight I'm joined by Bradley Smith from the Berks History Center and Rebecca Hughes from Friends of Hopewell Furnace and the Daniel Boone Homestead. How are you both doing tonight?
Doing well. How are you?
Good, good. So Brad's going to talk a little bit about some upcoming workshops at the History Center, and then Becky's actually going to talk a little bit about some upcoming events and programs at just some of the Berks Heritage Council sites, and then maybe a little bit about the Homestead and Hopewell as well. So Brad, I think you're up first. If you just want to give us a real brief rundown of the History Center, but you've been on a lot this, well, not this year, but last year. So I think our viewers are probably pretty familiar. But I know it's always good to give clarity there with the name change and everything. So give us a little background, and then I think some of these Easter-themed workshops, if you can imagine. It's not that far off.
Sure, sounds good. So I work at the Berks History Center, but we're better known as the Historical Society of Berks County. That's the name under which we were incorporated in 1869, so over 150 years ago. And we changed the name about a decade ago to the Berks History Center, at least as the name by which we do business. Legally, we're still the Historical Society of Berks County, but they changed the name because nationwide, there's been sort of a feeling that Historical Society has a little bit of an old-fashioned connotation, and a lot of our local historical societies have actually made this change. York County Historical Society, Lancaster County, Berks County. These are all historical societies that change the name by which they do business as a way to seem a little more contemporary and a little less stuffy. So we've been around a long, long time. We've been in our current home in the Center Park Historic District on the northern edge of Reading. We've been there since 1929. So we've been in our current location, which was our third permanent home, for nearly 100 years. And so we've got, the Berks County has a lot of great history, as many of our viewers know, but even just our organization has a lot of great history. And with all the interesting things that have happened to us as an organization, one could easily write a book. And I think it would be a pretty compelling story about the trials and tribulations of running a small county historical society.
Yeah, I'm sure a lot are in the same similar boat. So maybe a collaborative effort.
Yes, but we have so much fun. We really, really love what we do, and I really just appreciate the opportunity to get to meet so many people who appreciate our heritage in Berks County. So it's a great place to work and a great way to be a part of the larger Berks County community. And part of that is being involved with the Berks Heritage Council. So just it's just a lot of fun to be connected to a larger community like that.
Yeah. Well, and it always seems like you guys have something going on. So I know the last time you've been talking a lot about the Pennsylvania German workshops. Mm-hmm. That you guys have been doing, and the whole virtual and how you guys had to adapt that during COVID, and then even mm-hmm. some of your second Saturday programs?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, correct. Yeah,
that some of those have now, you've started offering those both, I guess, kind of hybrid, dual, virtual and in person. So
mm-hmm. correct. And in fact, by the time this recording airs, we'll have completed our first hybrid program, It hasn't happened yet, but by the time of the air date, it will have happened.
Okay.
We'll see if that's successful. But I'm optimistic. I'm really looking forward to that too. Yes.
Well, we'll have to have you on the show again, and then you can share how successful it was. It was.
So,
but all kidding aside, I know a lot of Heritage Council members are looking forward to hearing how that goes, because we want to pick your brain and see if it's something others can try and build off of. So.
Sure, and I'm sure there will be about 5 things we do wrong, but again, it'll be, yeah, exactly as you said, it'll be good trial and error that I can report to the rest of the gang, so to speak. And
You can work out all the issues and then just report back to everybody else, so when we do it, it'll go nice and smooth.
Exactly. So I can say, whatever you do, don't do what I did. X, Y, and Z.
Oh boy. So you have some upcoming workshops, correct?
We do. And we've always done some workshops. In particular, our educator, Vicki Hefner, really has a lot of expertise in basket making.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And so she's been doing basket workshops for years. But we also now have a second staff person, Amber Roman, who she's our curator. And while her master's degree is in public history, her bachelor's degree is in fine art. So she's got a very strong art background. And so she really started doing art workshops, maybe about 4 years ago. And they've been extremely popular. And at first she kept it kind of simple with painting classes. But just in the last few months, she's sort of broadened the horizons a little bit. In 2023, she started a printmaking workshop, and what I'd like to talk about today are some of the interesting, somewhat outside the box workshops she's got planned for the upcoming weeks here in 2024.
Yeah. So, just let me know. I think I have some photos here.
Sure.
Well,
I'll start by saying that you mentioned the Pennsylvania Dutch workshops.
Yes.
And to those who missed last month's program, what Amanda was referring to is these are actual language workshops where we teach people a little bit about the language and the culture of the Pennsylvania Dutch. And so that's something that I am the coordinator for. And that's really language learning. It has nothing to do with art, which I'm actually very, very bad at. But again, Amber does our art workshops, and she's really kind of tapped into that Pennsylvania Dutch folk art theme. Now, a lot of people in Berks County, of course, aren't from a Pennsylvania Dutch background. Many are, but many aren't. But one thing interesting about the Pennsylvania Dutch is they have such a rich, rich tradition of folk art that really kind of made them unique among the different cultural groups living in Pennsylvania in the 1700s and the 1800s and the 1900s. And so a lot of these workshops Amber is planning really celebrate that rich folk art heritage of the Pennsylvania Dutch. And I think are going to be a lot of fun for anyone, regardless of what their background is, because they're neat examples of art. So the first one I was going to tell you about is, by the time of this broadcast will be coming soon, on February 3rd, she's leading a Shear and Schnitta workshop. I don't know if you can see that picture. We have a picture to show about that. So that is an example of Shear and Schnitta. That's a Pennsylvania Dutch tradition of creating artistic designs using paper and strategic cutting. Some of you might remember, I remember this from elementary school when we'd make snowflakes.
Yes.
Holding a piece of paper and cutting a design, making it round and cutting a design and then unfolding it. That's the basic premise of Shear and Schnitta. So, and the one on the screen here is one that Amber did herself as sort of a test run just to see if she had the skill set. And as you can see, she definitely does. She's very good at all the art things she does. So that, and again, that's part of this larger Pennsylvania Dutch tradition of folk art. One thing interesting about the Pennsylvania Dutch is they just were always looking for an excuse to to add artistic flair to almost anything they'd make, even like barn hinges or kitchen utensils, that whatever it was, furniture, that just art was everywhere. It was everywhere in the world of the Pennsylvania Dutch. And so Sheeran Schnitte is just one small example in that larger tradition. And so that workshop is on February 3rd from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. And it's $30 for members, $35 for non-members, something worth checking out. But for those who think, well, maybe that's not quite of interest to me, coming in March, we have two Easter-themed workshops. And that leads to something I actually wanted to mention about the Pennsylvania Dutch. So the Pennsylvania Dutch, a lot of people don't know this. When they came over, they brought their unique food, like pig stomach and pork and sauerkraut and things like that. They brought their unique artwork. They brought lots and lots of things. They brought their unique language, but they also brought some interesting folk traditions. And for example, the earliest known image of a Christmas tree in North America comes from a Pennsylvania Dutch artist who lived in York County. The earliest mention of a Christmas tree in writing, and these are coming from the early 1800s, the earliest mention of a Christmas tree in writing in North America, to my knowledge, comes from Lancaster County, Pennsylvania, in the early 1800s, from a Pennsylvania Dutch family. Interestingly enough, the earliest image of an Easter bunny drawn or rendered, I should say, illustrated in North America or anywhere in the Western Hemisphere came from Berks County, Pennsylvania. And there it is right there, by an artist named Conrad Gilbert. So he actually lived. And this is something, this drawing is from about 1800. It's one of two that survive. And so Conrad Gilbert was a school teacher by trade, but he also was a fropter artist. And he would make these little illustrations and give them to his students as prizes for good behavior, doing a good job in school. And two of these Easter Bunny illustrations that he rendered about 1800 still survive. One is in the Winter Museum in Wilmington, Delaware. Then this example is actually in the Folk Art Museum at Colonial Williamsburg in Virginia. So again, these are the earliest images of the Easter Bunny in the Western Hemisphere that came right from Berks County. Although I should qualify that. Conrad Gilbert lived around what is today Orwigsburg, Pennsylvania. That is in Schuylkill County, but Schuylkill County wasn't established until I believe it was 1818. So at the time it was Berks County, but he actually lived in what is today Schuylkill. Okay. So, but I tell people he was from Berks County because that's—
But we can claim him.
Yeah. He, if you asked Conrad Gilbert, where do you live? What county do you live in? He'd say Berks County. So, but anyway, so this is a really unique claim to fame for Berks County. And coming up in March, Amber's going to lead two art workshops to kind of recreate this original Easter Bunny image. And those are on March 16th and March 21st. One is a morning program, one is an evening program. So folks can pick either one.
Oh, cool.
Whichever works for their schedule. And design their own early Pennsylvania Dutch Easter Bunny. But then another tradition we wanted to kind of focus on in our workshops are Easter eggs, because Pennsylvania Dutch were were very much instrumental in, I shouldn't say instrumental, but Easter eggs were part of Pennsylvania Dutch tradition as well. And in particular, they created a type of egg known as a scratch egg. And that's what you're seeing on the screen here. And these are scratch eggs from the collection of the Berks History Center. The earliest scratch eggs we have in our collection are probably about 1840 or thereabouts. There might be one a little earlier than that, I'm forgetting. The earliest that I've ever seen, however, the State Museum of Pennsylvania in Harrisburg has a scratch egg with a date in the 1790s. The date's actually scratched into it. I think it's 1793 or something like that.
Oh my God.
So in other words, this is an old, old tradition that's been around for hundreds of years. And the way it worked is a person creating a scratch egg would take an egg, a hard-boiled egg, and they would dye it. And a lot of times, like these brown ones, the dye comes from onion skins. So then they dye it and it would be a solid brown color. And then they take a little tool and slowly scratch off little pieces of the little chips of the dye. And by scratching off some of the dye, they would create an illustration. And that's what you see in these examples on the screen. So these are works by artists of the 1800s who are very, very talented. To me, it's amazing the way that you can see, get this sort of texture and depth just by scratching off little flakes of dye from an egg. And yet this is what artists were able to do. And we're going to be having two scratch egg workshops led by Amber, where Amber will teach anyone interested how to do this and teach them about the tradition, and give folks an opportunity to make their own Pennsylvania Dutch scratch eggs using the old traditions that artists have used many, many years ago. So those workshops are on March 9th in the afternoon and March 14th in the evening. And so
I feel like that requires a lot of patience.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
It's very intricate work.
And we have a lot of folks who will say, well, that sounds fun, but I'm really bad at art. I don't think it's for me. We always encourage people, it's not about creating a masterpiece. This is about doing something fun, meeting other people, and just celebrating a Berks County tradition that's been almost forgotten, but that we're trying to maintain as a historical society.
Very nice. Great. Well, I think it's just about time to switch over to Becky. But if we have any time after, maybe we'll circle back to you.
Okay. Can I just make one quick comment?
Of course.
So by the time this broadcast goes, we will have a completely revised website. It's our new website's about to go live, but it's berkshistory.org. And I just wanted to mention, for anyone interested in these programs, going to the new and improved website, berkshistory.org, will give you all the information that you might possibly want on these workshops. Or you can always call the History Center, 610-375-4375.
Well, that's something else I want to pick your brain about, too, is your new website, because Daniel Boone Homestead is also looking at a new website down the road. So.
Sure.
Becky and I will want to probably chat about that with you too at some point.
Yeah, well, we might have to have a planning meeting one of these days to go over all these things.
I know. But, all right, great. Well, thank you so much. And yeah, definitely check out the website, check out the new website, but also check out the website for information about all of those great upcoming workshops. And we will switch on over to Becky. How are you doing this evening? Oh, I think Becky's still on mute.
Okay, hold on. There we go.
There we go.
Now everybody Becky, can hear me.
Becky in her giraffe blanket. Hello, how are you?
I'm good.
So I know you have a couple of things you want to share about some of our council member sites that have upcoming events and programs. Did you want to start with those?
Yeah, I'll tell you some of the programs. So we have about like 50 museums on our Berks, in our Berks County Heritage Council, for anybody who doesn't know. And a couple of them gave me some information to tell you a little bit about some programs. So
awesome.
Hopewell Furnace, they have, the Friends of Hopewell Furnace have a second Sunday program every month. Yeah. And in February, the topic is going to be the people of Sixpenny Creek with Benjamin Carter.
Okay.
Sixpenny Creek was located right near French Creek State Park. So he's going to tell you a little bit about that. It was a big resort kind of area, I think.
Something like that. Okay. Okay.
I want to say the 1950s, somewhere around then. I don't know.
Okay. Cool.
So, they will have programs the second Sunday of every month going out throughout the whole year.
Okay.
The Leesport Area Historical Society has some upcoming programs. One of them is on Monday, January 22nd, which is when this program is airing. So
I think that is the night that this will air, yes.
But that program is on the history of Ahnelawney Lake.
Oh, fun. Ooh.
Yeah. These programs at the Leesport Area Historical Society are at Bethany Church, which is on 308 Main Street in Leesport, right there. That's where they hold these programs.
Okay.
Then they have two coming up in February. One is Sunday, February 4th. And that's not really a program, but more of an open house.
Is that at is that the schoolhouse, Becky? Do you know?
It's at the Historical Society Schoolhouse, yes.
Yes, yep. Okay.
Which is at 128 Main Street.
Yeah, right next to the playground, the Leesport Playground. Yep, okay, right, great, yep. Cool.
So I guess their programs are at the church, but they're, when they do the open house, it's at the school.
Yeah. I don't know if that's maybe just for like the winter time that they're at the church because it's cold. I don't think there's heat in there. I'm not sure. I don't know if it's there all the time. It might just also have better seating and stuff there. Who knows? But
right. Yeah.
Yeah. PowerPoint, so you know, screen.
Programs that Leesport Historical Society has.
Okay. Cool.
And then I guess you have a paper that you can show about quilt workshops, I think.
Quilt, yes. This so the is
Kutztown, Folk Festival is doing some quilting workshops, and they asked me to say a little bit about it. I guess they're looking for more people to sign up for their quilting workshops. So if anybody would like to sign up for them, you can go to the Kutztown Folk Festival website, and it should take you to a link that'll allow you to look at more information about them. They are starting the end of January or the very beginning of February.
Okay. Looks like one's I guess just kind of an info session. That one looks like it's free. And then there's a few that are workshops.
The class that runs, I think, through March, from January through March.
Yeah. Cool.
So if you want more information about that, just go to their website.
Okay.
And then the Daniel Boone Homestead, we are doing some programs through the winter months. We do them in January and February. We have a story time program that we do the first Friday of every month at 11 o'clock to history story time for preschoolers. And then we do a sewing circle on the first Saturday of every month from 10 to noon. So if you're into sewing, you can come and bring your project along and sew along with us.
I guess we should preface that with it's weather pending. Since
weather pending, Saturday. Yes. Last Saturday we actually canceled it. Or last Saturday. Yeah. And for anybody who would likes to walk around Daniel Boone Homestead, we do a third Sunday at 9 a.m. We do a pause on the path dog walk. Then you don't have to have a dog to come. You can just come and walk along with us.
And then pet everybody else's dog.
You can pet everybody else's dog. Yep.
I'm the best of all dogs.
We're trying to do those programs. Keep things going on throughout the winter there.
Yeah. Okay. And then the Daniel Boone Homestead also is doing a quilt making quilt workshop as well in March.
We will be celebrating Women's History Month. We have a lecture March 3rd on quilting, and then we will be doing a quilting workshop after
A couple weeks after, I guess, right? Yeah.
Yep.
Sounds good. Well, and of course, there's Charter Day, both at the Daniel Boone Homestead and also, I would assume, at Conrad Weiser. Charter Day is an event that all state-owned historic sites participate in, and it's a free open house. So I believe Conrad Weiser will probably be doing something that day. And I know we at Daniel Boone are also doing something that day. It'll be kind of our big living history event kickoff for 2024. So definitely keep your eyes peeled for details about that. But I think Conrad Weiser also, who's a Heritage Council member, will be doing something that day as well.
We have a Facebook page. The Berks County Heritage Council has a Facebook page.
Yes.
And we've been posting events for all sorts of programs on there. So if you check that out, there might be some other programs coming up, some other historic sites in Berks County. So
true. Yeah. I know a lot of our members are closed for January and February for cleaning and exhibit installation and things like that. And some are open with kind of limited hours or hours by appointment or, you know, things like that. So you can also contact the council through our Facebook page if you have questions, or just reach out to sites and museums directly and find out, you know, their hours.
Yep.
All right, great. Okay, well, thank you both so much for joining me tonight. It was nice to hear about some of the other member sites and what they have going on through the winter months. And of course, it's always fun to hear what the Berks History Center is doing. And those art workshops definitely sound super cool. I'd be one of those people that says I'm not very artistic, so I would hesitate to pretend. Becky's shaking her head too, but
yeah, not artistic.
Well, I don't have the patience for that egg. Well, I don't have the patience for the share shittily. Too much tiny cutting. I'd just be like, no, I'm out of here. But all right. Well, again, thank you both, and thank you to our viewers for tuning in. And I was gonna say stay dry, but we know this is gonna air not tonight, which of course we are getting torrential rains the night that we're taping this, but of course when it airs, it will hopefully not be raining. So I will say thank you again, and thanks to our viewers, and have a great rest of your night. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Sights and Sounds of Historic Berks on BCTV is supported by the Berks Heritage Council.